Harry Potter's from the Wizarding World, so they weren't too happy about that. Nearly 10 years has passed since the Dursleys had woken up to find the nephew on the front step. But Privet Drive had hardly changed at all. The sun rose on the same tiny front gardens and lit up the brass number 4 on the Dursleys' front door. It crept through their living room, which was almost exactly the same as it had been on the night when Mr. Dursley had seen that fateful news report about the owls. Only the photographs on the mantelpiece really showed how much time had passed. 10 years ago, there had been lots of pictures of what looked like a large pink beach ball wearing different colored bobble hats. But Dudley Dursley was no longer a baby. And now the photographs showed a large, blonde boy riding his first bicycle on a roundabout at the fair, playing a computer game with his father, being hugged and kissed by his mother. The room held no sign at all that another boy lived in the house, too. Yet Harry Potter was still there, asleep at the moment, but not for long. His Aunt Petunia was awake, and it was her shrill voice which made the first noise of the day. Up! Get up now! Harry woke with a start. His aunt rapped on the door again. Up! She screeched. Harry heard her walking towards the kitchen and then the sound of the frying pan being put on the cooker. He rolled onto his back and tried to remember the dream he had been having. It had been a good one. There had been a flying motorbike in it. He had a funny feeling he had the same dream before. His aunt was back outside the door. Are you up yet? She demanded. Nearly, said Harry. Well, get a move on. I want you to look after the bacon. And don't you dare let it burn. I want everything perfect on Duddy's birthday. Harry groaned. What did you say? His aunt snapped through the door.
Nothing.
Dudley's birthday. How could he have forgotten? Harry got slowly out of bed and started looking for socks. He found a pair under his bed and, after pulling a spider off one of them, put them on. Harry was used to spiders because the cupboard under the stairs was full of them, and that was where he slept. When he was dressed, he went down the hall into the kitchen. The table was almost hidden beneath all Dudley's birthday presents. It looked as though Dudley had gotten the new computer he wanted, not to mention the second television and the racing bike. Exactly why Dudley wanted a racing bike was a mystery to Harry, as Dudley was very fat and hated exercise, unless of course it involved punching somebody. Dudley's favorite punch bag was Harry. But he couldn't often catch him. Harry didn't look it, but he was very fast. Perhaps it had something to do with living in a dark cupboard. But Harry had always been small and skinny for his age. He looked even smaller and skinnier than he really was, because all he had to wear were old clothes of Dudley's, and Dudley was about 4 times bigger than he was. Harry had a thin face, knobbly knees, black hair, and bright green eyes. He wore round glasses held together with a lot of sellotape because of all the times Dudley had punched him in the nose. The only thing Harry liked about his own appearance was a very thin scar on his forehead, which was the shape of a bolt of lightning. He had it as long as he could remember, and the first question he could ever remember asking Aunt Petunia was how he got it. In the car crash when your parents died, she said, and don't ask questions. Don't ask questions. That was the first rule for a quiet life with the Dursleys. Uncle Vernon entered the kitchen as Harry was turning over the bacon. Comb your hair, he barked by the way of a morning greeting. About once a week, Uncle Vernon looked over the top of the newspaper and shouted that Harry needed a haircut. Harry must have had more haircuts than the rest of the boys in his class put together. But it made no difference. His hair simply grew that way, all over the place. Ooh, nasty. There's him in the cupboard with the spiders. So creepy. Okay, I think we can be done with you, Ron. It'd be nice if I had a picture of Harry. Well, there's Harry on the left. Okay. Ooh, there's more of the spiders. Look at that. All over on this page. So many spiders in that cupboard. I would not want to live there. Harry was frying eggs by the time Dudley arrived in the kitchen with his mother. Dudley looked a lot like Uncle Vernon. He had a large, pink face, not much neck, small, watery blue eyes, and thick blonde hair that lay smoothly on his thick, fat head. Do you notice that most of the bad guys in this book have blonde hair? I wonder if J.K. Rowling just hates people with blonde hair. Doesn't she have blonde hair? Self-hatred. Okay. Anyway, Aunt Petunia often said that Dudley looked a lot like a baby angel. Harry often said that Dudley looked like a pig in a wig. Harry put the plates of egg and bacon on the table, which was difficult as there wasn't much room. Dudley, meanwhile, was counting his presents. His face fell. 36, he said, looking up at his mother and father. That's two less than last year. Darling, you haven't counted Auntie Marjorie's presents. See, it's here under the big one from Mummy and Daddy. All right, 37 then, said Dudley, going red in the face. Harry, who could see a huge Dudley tantrum coming on, began wolfing down his bacon as fast as possible in case Dudley turned the table over. Aunt Petunia obviously scented danger too, because she said quickly, "And we'll buy you another two presents while we're out today. How's that, Pupkin? Two more presents, is that all right?" That's good parenting for you. Dudley thought for a moment. It looked like hard work. Finally he said, that's funny. Thinking is hard work for Dudley. Finally he said slowly, "So I'll have 39, sweetums," said Aunt Petunia. "Oh," Dudley sat down heavily and grabbed the nearest parcel. "All right then," Uncle Vernon chuckled. "Little tyke wants his money's worth, just like his father. Atta boy, Dudley," and he ruffled Dudley's hair. At that moment, the telephone rang and Aunt Petunia went to answer it while Harry and Uncle Vernon watched Dudley unwrap the racing bike, a cine camera, a remote control airplane, 6 new computer games, and a video recorder. He was ripping the paper off a gold wristwatch when Aunt Petunia came back from the telephone looking both angry and worried. "Bad news, Vernon," she said. "Mrs. Fig's broken a leg. She can't take him." She jerked her head in Harry's direction. Dudley's mouth fell open in horror, but Harry's heart gave a leap. Every year on Dudley's birthday, his parents took him and a friend out for the day to adventure parks, hamburger bars, or the cinema. Every year, Harry was left behind with Mrs. Fig, a mad old lady who lives 2 streets away. Harry hated it there. The whole house smelled of cabbage, and Mrs. Fig made him look at photographs of all the cats she'd ever owned. "Now what?" said Aunt Petunia, looking furiously at Harry as though he planned this. Harry knew he ought to feel sorry for that Mrs. Fig broke her leg, but it wasn't easy when he reminded himself it would be a whole year before he had to look at Tibbles, Snowy, Mr. Paws, and Tufty again. "We could phone Marge," Uncle Vernon suggested. "Don't be silly, Vernon! She hates the boy!" The Dursleys often spoke about Harry as though he wasn't there, or rather, as though he was something very nasty that couldn't understand them, like a slug.
"What about, what's her name? Your friend Yvonne?"
"On holiday in Majorca."
What is this Majorca that everyone likes in England? Where even is that?
"You could just leave me here," Harry put in hopefully. He'd be able to watch what he wanted on television for a change, and maybe even have a go on Dudley's computer.
Aunt Petunia looked as though she just swallowed a lemon.
"And come back and find the house in ruins," she snarled.
"I won't blow up the house," said Harry, but they weren't listening.
"I suppose we could take him to the zoo," said Aunt Petunia slowly, "and leave him in the car."
"That car's new. He's not sitting in it alone."
Dudley began to cry loudly. In fact, he wasn't really crying. It had been years since he really cried, but he knew that if he screwed up his face and wailed, his mother would give him anything he wanted.
"Tinky Dunny Dumps, don't cry! Mommy won't let him spoil your special day," she cried, flinging her arms around him. "I don't want him to come!" Dudley yelled between huge pretend sobs. "He always spoils everything!
He shot Harry a nasty grin through the gap in his mother's arms. Just then the doorbell rang.
Oh, good Lord, they're here!
Said Aunt Petunia frantically, and a moment later, Dudley's best friend, Piers Polkis, walked in with his mother. Piers was a scrawny boy with a face like a rat. He was usually the one people held at arm's length behind the backs while Dudley hit them. Dudley stopped pretending to cry at once. Half an hour later, Harry, who couldn't believe his luck, was sitting in the back of the Dursleys' car with Piers and Dudley on his way to the zoo for the first time in his life. His aunt and uncle hadn't been able to think of anything else to do with him. But before they'd left, Uncle Vernon had taken Harry aside.
I'm warning you,
he had said, putting a large purple face right up close to Harry's.
I'm warning you, boy. Any funny business, anything at all, and you'll be in the cupboard from now until Christmas.
I'm not gonna do anything, said Harry, honestly. But Uncle Vernon didn't believe him. No one ever did. The problem was, strange things often happened around Harry, and it was just no good to tell the Dursleys he didn't make them happen. Once Aunt Petunia, tired of Harry coming back from the barber's, looking as though he hadn't been at all, had taken a pair of kitchen scissors and cut his hair so short he was almost bald except for fringe, which she left to hide that horrible scar. Dudley had laughed himself silly at Harry, who spent a sleepless night imagining school the next day, where he was already laughed at for his baggy clothes and sellotaped glasses. Next morning, however, he got up to find his hair exactly as it had been before Aunt Petunia had sheared it off. He had been given a week in the cupboard for this, even though he had tried to explain that he couldn't explain how it had been grown back so quickly. Another time, Aunt Petunia had been trying to force him into a revolting jumper of Dudley's, brown with orange bubbles. The harder she tried to pull it over his head, the smaller it seemed to become. Until finally, it might have fitted a glove puppet, but certainly wouldn't fit Harry. Aunt Petunia had decided it must have shrunk in the wash, and to his great relief, Harry wasn't punished. On the other hand, he'd got into terrible trouble for being found on the roof of school kitchens. Dudley's gang had been chasing him as usual. As much to Harry's surprise as anyone else's, there he was, sitting on the chimney. The Dursleys had received a very angry letter from Harry's headmistress telling them how Harry had been climbing school buildings. But all he tried to do, as he shouted at Uncle Vernon through the locked door of his cupboard, was jump behind the big bins outside the kitchen doors. Harry supposed that the wind must have caught him mid-jump. Sure. Seems right. Why not? It was the wind. But today, nothing was going to go wrong. It was even worth being with Dudley and Piers. To be spending the day somewhere that wasn't school, his cupboard, or Mrs. Fig's cabbage-smelling living room. While he drove, Uncle Vernon complained to Aunt Petunia. He liked to complain about things. People at work, Harry, the council, Harry, the bank, and Harry were just a few of his favorite subjects. This morning, it was motorbikes. My hat looks so ridiculous. Motorbikes roaring around like maniacs, the young hoodlums, he said as a motorbike overtook them. I had a dream about a motorbike, said Harry, remembering suddenly. It was flying. Uncle Vernon nearly crashed into the car in front. He turned round in his seat and yelled at Harry, his face like a gigantic beetroot with a mustache. Motorbikes don't fly!
Oh, hey! Thank you, XAU, for the cheer. Woohoo!
Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Dudley and Piers sniggered. I know they don't, said Harry. It was only a dream. But he wished he hadn't said anything. If there was one thing the Dursleys hated even more than his asking questions, It was his talking about anything that acted in a way it shouldn't, no matter if it was in a dream or even a cartoon. They seemed to think he might get dangerous ideas. It was a very sunny Saturday at the zoo and the zoo was crowded with families. The Dursleys bought Dudley and Pia's large chocolate ice creams at the entrance, and then, because the smiley lady in the van had asked Harry what he wanted before they could hurry him away, they bought him a cheap lemon ice lolly. Aw, yay. It wasn't bad either, Harry thought, licking it as they watched a gorilla scratching his head and looking remarkably like Dudley, except that it wasn't blonde. Harry had the best morning he had in a long time. Here's the gorilla. And here is Dudley. Looks kind of like a bald, blonde gorilla. Uh-huh, thank you for the love. I appreciate it. Okay. Where are we? Harry was careful to walk a little way apart from the Dursleys so that Dudley and Piers, who were starting to get bored with the animals by lunchtime, wouldn't fall back on the favorite hobby of hitting him. They ate in the zoo restaurant, and when Dudley had a tantrum because his Knickerbocker glory wasn't big enough, Uncle Vernon bought him another one, and Harry was allowed to finish the first. Oh, okay. Harry felt afterwards that he should have known it was all too good to last. After lunch, they went to the reptile house. It was cool and dark in here, with lit windows all along the walls. Behind the glass, all sorts of lizards and snakes were crawling and slithering over bits of wood and stone. Dudley and Piers wanted to see huge, poisonous cobras and thick, man-crushing pythons. Dudley quickly found the largest snake in the place. It could have wrapped its body twice around Uncle Vernon's car and crushed it into a dustbin, but at the moment, it didn't look in the mood. In fact, it was asleep. Dudley stood with his nose pressed against the glass, staring at the glistening brown coils. "Make it move!" he whined at his father. Uncle Vernon tapped on the glass, but the snake didn't budge. "Do it again!" Dudley ordered. Uncle Vernon rapped the glass smartly with his knuckles, but the snake just snoozed on. "This is boring!" Dudley moaned. He shuffled away. Harry moved in front of the tank and looked intently at the snake. He wouldn't have been surprised if it had died of boredom itself. No company except stupid people drumming their fingers on the glass trying to disturb it all day. It was worse than having a cupboard as a bedroom, where the only visitor was Aunt Petunia hammering on the door to wake you up. At least he got to visit the rest of the house. The snake suddenly opened its beady eyes. Slowly, very slowly, it raised its head until its eyes were on level with Harry's. It winked. Harry stared. Then he looked quickly around to see if anyone was watching. They weren't. He looked back at the snake and winked too. The snake jerked its head towards Uncle Vernon and Dudley. Then it raised its eyes to the ceiling. It gave Harry a look that said, quite plainly, "I get that all the time." "I know," Harry murmured through the glass, though he wasn't sure the snake could hear him. "It must be really annoying." The snake nodded vigorously. "Where did you come from anyway?" Harry asked. The snake jabbed its tail at a little sign next to the glass. Harry peered at it. "Boa constrictor, Brazil." "Was it nice there?" The boa constrictor jabbed its tail at the sign again, and Harry read on. "This specimen was bred in the zoo." "Oh, I see. So you've never been to Brazil." As the snake shook its head, a deafening shout behind Harry made both of them jump.
"Dudley! Mr. Dursley, come and look at the snake! You won't believe what it's doing!"
Dudley came waddling towards them as fast as he could.
"Out of the way, you!"
he said, punching Harry in the ribs. Caught by surprise, Harry fell hard on the concrete floor. What came next happened so fast that no one saw how it happened. One second, Piers and Dudley were leaning right up close to the glass. The next, they had leapt back with howls of horror. Harry sat up and gasped. The glass front of the boa constrictor's tank had vanished. The great snake was uncoiling itself rapidly, slithering out on the floor. People throughout the reptile house screamed and started running for the exits. As the snake slid swiftly past him, Harry could have sworn a low, hissing voice said, Brazil, here I come. Thanks, amigo. The keeper of the reptile house was in shock.
But the glass, he kept saying. Where did the glass go?
The zoo director himself made Aunt Petunia a cup of strong, sweet tea while he apologized over and over again. Piers and Dudley could only gibber. As far as Harry had seen, the snake hadn't done anything except snap playfully at their heels as he passed. But by the time they were all back in Uncle Vernon's car, Dudley was telling them how it nearly bitten off his leg, while Piers was swearing it had tried to squeeze him to death. But worst of all, for Harry at least, was Piers calming down enough to say, Harry was talking to it, weren't you, Harry? Uncle Vernon waited until Piers was safely out of the house before starting on Harry. He was so angry, he could hardly speak. He managed to say,
Go! Cupboard! Stay! No meals!
Before he collapsed into a chair, and Aunt Petunia had to run and get him a large brandy. Harry lay in his dark cupboard much later, wishing he had a watch. He didn't know what time it was, and he couldn't be sure the Dursleys were asleep yet until they were. He couldn't risk sneaking into the kitchen for some food. He lived with the Dursleys almost 10 years. 10 miserable years. As long as he could remember. Ever since he'd been a baby and his parents had died in that car crash. He couldn't remember being in the car when his parents had died. Sometimes he strained his memory during long hours in the cupboard. He came up with a strange vision. A blinding flash of green light and a burning pain on his forehead. This, he supposed, was the crash, though he couldn't imagine where all the green light came from. He couldn't remember his parents at all. His aunt and uncle never spoke about them, and of course he was forbidden to ask questions. There were no photographs of them in the house. When he had been younger, Harry had dreamed and dreamed of some unknown relation coming to take him away, but it had never happened. The Dursleys were his only family. Yet sometimes he thought, or maybe hoped, that strangers in the street seemed to know him. Very strange strangers they were, too. A tiny man in a violet top hat had bowed to him once, while out shopping with Aunt Petunia and Dudley. After asking Harry, furiously, if he knew the man, Aunt Petunia had rushed them out of the shop without buying anything. A wild-looking old woman dressed all in green had waved merrily at him once on a bus. A bald man in a very long purple coat had actually shaken his hand in the street the other day and then walked away without a word. The weirdest thing about all these people was the way they seemed to vanish the second Harry tried to get a closer look. At school, Harry had no one. Everybody knew Dudley's gang hated that odd Harry Potter and his baggy old clothes and broken glasses, and nobody liked to disagree with Dudley's gang. How sad for Harry, but we know from the first chapter that there are some funny people in the magic area. I don't know what they called them. I don't know, the Dursleys call them just like magic people or something. I don't know what they call them, but anyway, we know that there were some magic people and they were very happy on the day that Harry got brought to the Dursleys, because that's the day that he who must not be named was stopped. We don't know a whole lot about it yet, but that's what we were told, and so it makes sense that these people would know Harry if they knew, you know, he was the one who didn't get killed by he who must not be named. Harry doesn't know that, but we learned it in the first chapter, so that must be why those people are looking at him. So I find that interesting. Okay. We're on chapter 3. The letters from no one. The escape of the Brazilian boa constrictor earned Harry his longest ever punishment. By the time he was allowed out of his cupboard again, the summer holidays had started and Dudley had already broken his new cinema camera, crashed his remote control aeroplane, and first time on his racing bike, knocked down old Mrs. Fig as she crossed Privet Drive on her crutches. How horrible. And he was in his cupboard until summer holidays? I mean, he missed school. Wouldn't the Dursleys get arrested for that? Harry was glad school was over, but there was no escaping Dudley's gang, who visited the house every single day. Piers, Dennis, Malcolm, and Gordon were all big and stupid, but as Dudley was the biggest and stupidest of the lot, he was the leader. The rest of them were all quite happy to join in on Dudley's favorite sport, Harry hunting. That was why Harry spent as much time as possible out of the house, wandering around and thinking about the end of the holidays where he could see a tiny ray of hope. When September came, he would be going off to the secondary school, and for the first time in his life, he wouldn't be with Dudley. Dudley had a place at Uncle Vernon's old school, Smeltings. Piers Polkis was going there too. Harry, on the other hand, was going to Stonewall High, the local comprehensive. Dudley thought this was very funny. "They stuff people's heads down the toilet the first day at Stonewall," he told Harry. "Want to come upstairs and practice?" "No thanks," said Harry. "The poor toilet's never had anything as horrible as your head down it. It might be sick." Then he ran before Dudley could work out what he said. One day in July, Aunt Petunia took Dudley to London to buy his Smeltings uniform, leaving Harry at Mrs. Fig's. Mrs. Fig wasn't as bad as usual. It turned out she'd broken her leg tripping over one of her cats, and she didn't seem quite as fond of them as before. She let Harry watch television and gave him a bit of chocolate cake that tasted as though she had it for several years. That evening, Dudley paraded around the living room for the family in his brand new uniform. Smelting boys wore maroon tailcoats, orange knickerbockers, and flat straw hats called boaters. They also carried knobbly sticks used for hitting each other while the teachers weren't looking. This was supposed to be good training for later in life. As he looked at Dudley in his new knickerbockers, Uncle Vernon said gruffly that it was the proudest moment of his life. Aunt Petunia burst into tears and she couldn't believe it was a ickle Duddykins. He looked so handsome and grown up. Harry didn't trust himself to speak. He thought two of his ribs might have already cracked from trying not to laugh. And here's the picture of him in his uniform. Such a funny hat. There was a horrible smell in the kitchen next morning when Harry went in for breakfast. It seemed to be coming from a large metal tub in the sink. He went to have a look. The tub was full of what looked like dirty rags swimming in grey water. "What's this?" he asked Aunt Petunia. Her lips tightened as they always did if he dared to ask a question. "Your new school uniform," she said. Harry looked in the bowl. "Oh," he said. "I didn't realize it had to be so wet." "Don't be stupid," snapped Aunt Petunia. "I'm dyeing some of old Dudley's old things gray for you. It'll look just like everyone else's when I finished." Harry seriously doubted this, but thought it best not to argue. He sat down at the table and tried not to think about how he was going to look on his first day at Stonewall High, like he was wearing bits of old elephant skin, probably. Dudley and Uncle Vernon came in, both with wrinkled noses because of the smell from Harry's new uniform. Uncle Vernon opened his newspapers as usual, and Dudley banged his smelting stick, which he carried everywhere, on the table. They heard the click of the letterbox, and a flop of letters on the doormat. "Get the post, Dudley," said Uncle Vernon from behind his paper. "Make Harry get it." "Get the post, Harry." "Make Dudley get it." "Poke him with your smelting stick, Dudley." Harry dodged the smelting stick and went to get the post. Three things lay on the doormat. A postcard from Uncle Vernon's sister Marge, who was holidaying on the Isle of Wight. A brown envelope that looked like a bill. And a letter for Harry. Harry picked it up and stared at it, his heart twanging like a giant elastic band. No one ever in his whole life had written to him. Who would? He had no friends, no other relatives. He didn't belong to the library, so he never even got rude notes asking for books back. Yet Here it was, a letter addressed so plainly there could be no mistake. Mr. H. Potter, the cupboard under the stairs, 4 Privet Drive, Little Winging, Surrey. The envelope was thick and heavy, made of yellowish parchment, and the address was written in emerald green ink. There was no stamp. Turning the envelope over, his hand trembling, Harry saw a purple wax seal bearing a coat of arms, a lion, an eagle, a badger, and a snake, surrounding a large letter H.
"Hurry up, boy!" shouted Uncle Vernon from the kitchen. "What are you doing checking for letter bombs?"
He chuckled at his own joke. Harry went back to the kitchen, still staring at his letter. He handed Uncle Vernon the bill and the postcard, sat down, and slowly began to open the yellow envelope. Uncle Vernon ripped open the bill, snorted in disgust, and flipped over the postcard.
"Marge is ill," he informed Aunt Petunia. "Ate a funny whelk."
"Dad!" said Dudley suddenly. "Dad, Harry's got something!"
Harry was on the point of unfolding his letter, which was written on the same heavy parchment as the envelope, when it was jerked sharply out of his hand by Uncle Vernon.
"That's mine," said Harry, trying to snatch it back.
"Who'd be writing to you?"
sneered Uncle Vernon, shaking the letter open with one hand and glancing at it. His face went from red to green faster than a set of traffic lights. And it didn't stop there. Within seconds, it was the grayish white of old porridge.
"Petunia!" he gasped.
Dudley tried to grab the letter to read it, but Uncle Vernon held it high out of his reach. Aunt Petunia took it curiously and read the first line. For a moment, it looked as though she might faint. She clutched her throat and made choking noise.
"Vernon! Oh my goodness, Vernon!"
They stared at each other, seeming to have forgotten that Harry and Dudley were still in the room. Dudley wasn't used to being ignored. He gave his father a sharp tap on the head with his smelting stick.
"I want to read that letter," he said loudly. "I want to read it!"
"I want to read it," said Harry furiously, "as it's mine."
"Get out, both of you," croaked
Uncle Vernon, stuffing the letter back in his envelope. Harry didn't move.
"I want my letter," he shouted. "Let me see it," demanded Dudley.
"Out,"
roared Uncle Vernon, and he took both Harry and Dudley by the scruffs of their necks and threw them into the hall, slamming the kitchen door behind them. Harry and Dudley promptly had a furious but silent fight over who would listen the keyhole. Dudley won, so Harry, his glasses dangling from one ear, lay flat on his stomach to listen at the crack between the door and floor.
"Vernon," Aunt Petunia was saying in a quivering voice, "look at the address. How could they possibly know where he sleeps? You don't think they're watching the house?"
"Watching? Spying? Might be following us," muttered Uncle Vernon.
"But what should we do, Vernon? Should we write back? Tell him we don't want..."
Harry could see Uncle Vernon's shiny black shoes pacing up and down the kitchen.
"No," he said finally. "No, we'll ignore it. If they don't get an answer, yes. That's it. That's best. We won't do anything."
"But..."
"I'm not having one in the house, Petunia."
"Didn't we swear when we took him in we'd stamp out the dangerous nonsense?"
That evening, when he got back from work, Uncle Vernon did something he'd never done before. He visited Harry in his cupboard.
"Where's my letter?"
said Harry, the moment Uncle Vernon had squeezed through the door. "Who's writing to me?"
"No one. It was addressed to you by mistake," said Uncle Vernon shortly. "I've burned it."
"It was not a mistake," said Harry angrily. "It had my cupboard on it."
"Silence!"
yelled Uncle Vernon, and a couple of spiders fell from the ceiling. He took a few deep breaths and then forced a face into a smile, which looked quite painful.
Harry, about the cupboard. Your aunt and I have been thinking. You're really getting a bit big for it. We think it might be nice if you moved into Dudley's second bedroom."
"Why?" said Harry.
"Don't ask questions!" snapped his uncle. "Take this stuff upstairs now."
The Dursleys' house had 4 bedrooms, one for Uncle Vernon and Aunt Petunia, one for visitors, usually Uncle Vernon's sister, Marge. One where Dudley slept, and one where Dudley kept all the toys and things that wouldn't fit into his first bedroom. It only took Harry one trip upstairs to move everything he owned from the cupboard to this room. He sat down on the bed and stared around him. Nearly everything in here was broken. The month-old cine camera was lying on top of a small working tank. Dudley had once driven over the door's dog. In the corner was Dudley's first ever television set, which he'd put his foot through when his favorite program had been cancelled. There was a large birdcage, which once had held a parrot that Dudley had swapped at school for a rear-air rifle, which was up on a shelf with the end all bent because Dudley had sat on it. Other shelves were full of books. They were the only things in the room that looked as though they had never been touched. From downstairs came the sound of Dudley bawling at his mother.
I don't want him in there! I need that room! Make him get out!
Harry sighed and stretched out on the bed. Yesterday he'd have given anything to be up here. Today he'd rather be back in his cupboard with that letter than up here without it. Next morning at breakfast, everyone was rather quiet. Dudley was in shock. He screamed, whacked his father with his smelting stick, been sick on purpose, kicked his mother, and thrown his tortoise through the green roof, and he still didn't have his room back. Harry was thinking about this time yesterday and bitterly wishing he'd opened the letter in the hall. Uncle Vernon and Aunt Petunia kept looking at each other darkly. When the post arrived, Uncle Vernon, who seemed to be trying to be nice to Harry, made Dudley go and get it. They heard him banging things with his smelting stick all the way down the hall. Then he shouted, "There's another one! Mr. H. Potter, the smallest bedroom, 4 Privet Drive!" With a strangled cry, Uncle Vernon leapt from his seat and ran down the hall, Harry right behind him. Uncle Vernon had to wrestle Dudley to the ground to get the letter from him, which made difficult by the fact that Harry had grabbed Uncle Vernon around the neck from behind. After a minute of confused fighting in which everyone got hit by the smelting stick, Uncle Vernon straightened up, gasping for breath, with Harry's letter clutched in his hand. "Go to your cupboard! I mean, your bedroom!" he wheezed at Harry. "Dudley, go! Just go!" Harry walked round and round his new room. Someone knew he had moved out of his cupboard, and they seemed to know he hadn't received his first letter. Surely they meant to try again, and this time they made sure he didn't fail. He had a plan. The repaired alarm clock rang at 6 o'clock the next morning. Harry turned it off quickly and dressed silently. He mustn't wake the Dursleys. He stole downstairs without turning out any of the lights. He was going to wait for the postman on the corner of Privet Drive and get the letters for number 4 first. His heart hammered as he crept across the dark hall towards the front door. And I just want to show you the picture. Oh! Harry leapt into the air. He trod in on something big, squashy on the doormat. Something alive. Lights clicked on upstairs, and to his horror, Harry realized the big, squashy something had been his uncle's face. Uncle Vernon had been lying at the foot of the front door in a sleeping bag, clearly making sure that Harry didn't do exactly what he'd been trying to do. He shouted at Harry for about half an hour, and then told him to go and make a cup of tea. Harry shuffled off miserably into the kitchen, and by the time he got back, the post had arrived right into Uncle Vernon's lap. Harry could see 3 letters addressed in green ink. "I want," he began, but Uncle Vernon was tearing the letters into pieces before his eyes. Uncle Vernon didn't go to work that day. He stayed at home and nailed up the letterbox. "See," he explained to Aunt Petunia through a mouthful of nails, "if they can't deliver them, they'll just give up."
"I'm not sure that will work, Vernon."
"Oh, these people's minds work in strange ways, Petunia. They're not like you and me," said Uncle Vernon, trying to knock in the nail with a piece of fruit cake that Aunt Petunia had just brought him. On Friday, no fewer than 12 letters arrived for Harry. As they couldn't go through the letterbox, they had been pushed under the door, slotted through the sides, and a few even forced through the small window in the downstairs toilet. Uncle Vernon stayed home again. After burning all the letters, he got out a hammer and nails and boarded up the cracks and the front and back doors so no one could go out. He hummed, "Tiptoe through the tulips," as he worked, and jumped at small noises. On Saturday, things began to get out of hand. 24 letters to Harry found their way into the house, rolled up and hidden inside each of the 2 dozen eggs that the very confused milkman had handed Aunt Petunia through the living room window. While Uncle Vernon made furious telephone calls to the post office in Derry trying to find someone to complain to, Aunt Petunia shredded the letters in her food mixer.
on earth wants to talk to you this much?
Dudley asked Harry in amazement. On Sunday morning, Uncle Vernon sat down at the breakfast table, looking tired and rather ill, but happy.
No post on Sundays,
he reminded them happily, as he spread marmalade on his newspapers. No damn letters today. Something came whizzing down the kitchen chimney as he spoke and caught him sharply on the back of the head. Next moment, 30 or 40 letters came pelting out of the fireplace like bullets. The Dursleys ducked, but Harry leapt into the air trying to catch one.
Out! Out!
Uncle Vernon seized Harry around the waist and threw him into the hall. When Aunt Petunia and Dudley had run out with their arms over their faces, Uncle Vernon slammed the door shut. They could hear the letters still streaming into the room, bouncing off the walls and floor.
That does it,
said Uncle Vernon, trying to speak calmly but putting great tufts of his mustache out at the same time.
I want you all back here in 5 minutes, ready to leave. We're going away. Just pack some clothes, no arguments.
He looked so dangerous with half his mustache missing that no one dared to argue. 10 minutes later, they wrenched through their way through the boarded-up doors and were in the car, speeding towards the motorway. Dudley was sniffling in the back seat. His father had hit him round the head for holding him up while he tried to pack his television, video, and computer into a sports bag. They drove and drove. Even Aunt Petunia didn't dare ask where they were going. Every now and then, Uncle Vernon would take a sharp turning and drive in the opposite direction for a while.
Shake 'em off! Shake 'em off! He would mutter whenever he did this.
They did not stop to eat or drink all day. By nightfall, Dudley was howling. He'd never had such a bad day in his life. He was hungry. He had missed 5 television programs he had wanted to see, and he had never gone so long without blowing up an alien on his computer. Uncle Vernon stopped at last outside a gloomy-looking hotel on the outskirts of the big city. Dudley and Harry shared a room with twin beds, damp, musty sheets. Dudley snored, but Harry stayed awake, sitting on the windowsill, staring down at the lights of passing cars and wondering. They ate stale cornflakes and cold tinned tomatoes on toast for breakfast the next day. They had just finished when the owner of the hotel came over to the table.
Excuse me, but is one of you Mr. H. Potter? Only, I got about 100 of these at my front desk.
He held up a letter so they could read it, the green ink address. Mr. H. Potter, room 17, Railview Hotel, Cokeworth. Harry made a grab for the letter, but Uncle Vernon knocked his hand out of the way. The woman stared.
I'll take them,
said Uncle Vernon, standing up quickly and following her from the dining room.
Wouldn't it be better to just go home, dear?
Aunt Petunia suggested timidly hours later. But Uncle Vernon didn't seem to hear her. Exactly what he was looking for, none of them knew. He drove them into the middle of a forest, got out, looked around, shook his head, got back into the car, and off they went again. The same thing happened in the middle of a plowed field, halfway across a suspension bridge, and at the top of a multi-story car park.
Daddy's gone mad, hasn't he?
Dudley asked Aunt Petunia dully late afternoon. Uncle Vernon had parked at the coast, locked them all inside the car, and disappeared. It started to rain. Great drops beat on the roof of the car. Dudley snivelled.
It's Monday, he told his letter. The Great Humberto's on tonight. I want to stay somewhere with the television.
Monday? This reminded Harry of something. If it was Monday, and you could usually count on Dudley to know the days of the week because of television, then tomorrow, Tuesday, was Harry's 11th birthday. Of course, his birthdays were never exactly fun. Last year, the Dursleys had given him a coat hanger and a pair of Uncle Vernon's old socks. Still, you weren't 11 every day. Uncle Vernon was back, and he was smiling. He was also carrying a long, thin package and didn't answer Aunt Petunia when she asked what he'd bought.
Found the perfect place, he said. Come on, everyone's out.
It was very cold outside the car. Uncle Vernon was pointing at what looked like a large rock way out to sea. Perched on top of that rock was the most miserable little shack you could imagine. One thing was certain, there was no television in there.
Storm forecast for tonight,
said Uncle Vernon gleefully, clapping his hands together.
And this gentleman's kindly agreed to lend us his boat.
A toothless old man came ambling up to them, pointing with a rather wicked grin, and an old rowing boat bobbing in at the iron gray water below them.
I've already got us some rations, said Uncle Vernon, so all aboard.
It was freezing in the boat, icy sea spray and the rain crept down their necks and a chilly wind whipped their faces. After what seemed like hours, they reached the rock where Uncle Vernon, slipping and sliding, led the way to the broken down house. The inside was horrible. It smelled strongly of seaweed. The wind whistled through the gaps in the wooden walls and the fireplace was damp and empty. There were only two rooms. Uncle Vernon's rations turned out to be packets of crisp each and four bananas. He tried to start a fire, but the empty crisp packets just smoked and shriveled up. Here's the picture of them. Rowing.
Could do with some of those letters now, eh?
He said cheerfully. He was in a very good mood. Obviously, he thought nobody stood a chance of reaching them out here in the storm to deliver post. Harry privately agreed, though the thought didn't cheer him up at all. As night fell, the promised storm blew up around them. Spray from the high waves splattered the walls of the hut, and a fierce wind rattled the filthy windows. Aunt Petunia found a few moldy blankets in the second room and made up a bed for Dudley on the moth-eaten sofa. She and Uncle Vernon went off to the lumpy bed next door, and Harry was left to find the softest bit of floor he could find to curl up under the thinnest, most ragged blanket. The storm raged more and more ferociously as the night went on. Harry couldn't sleep. He shivered and turned over, trying to get comfortable. His stomach was rumbling with hunger. Dudley's snores were drowned by the low rolls of thunder that started near midnight. The lighted dial of Dudley's watch, which was dangling over the edge of the sofa on his fat wrist, told Harry he had been 11. He'd be 11 in 10 minutes' time. He laid and watched his birthday tick nearer, wondering if the Dursleys would remember it all, wondering where the letter was now. 5 minutes to go, Harry heard something creak outside. He hoped the roof wasn't going to fall in, although it might be warmer if it did. 4 minutes to go. Maybe the house in Privet Drive would be so full of letters when they got back that he'd be able to steal one somehow. 3 minutes to go. Was that the sea, slapping hard on the rock like that? And 2 minutes to go. What was that funny crunching noise? Was the rock crumbling into the sea? 1 minute to go and he'd be 11. 30 seconds. 20, 10, 9, maybe he'd wake Dudley up just to annoy him. 3, 2, 1, boom! The whole shack shivered, and Harry sat bolt upright, staring at the door. Someone was outside, knocking to come in. And that is where we're going to stop for tonight. The next chapter, chapter 4, is called The Keeper of Keys. And if you liked hearing this story be read, anytime you come into my stream, you're welcome to ask me to read more of this book. I am actually reading Harry Potter and the Chamber of Secrets right now on my usual stream, story time stream, on Mondays. So every Monday at around 6:15, I will be reading Harry Potter and the Chamber of Secrets. But when I have free time, I will read Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone. So if you want to hear more of Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone, you're welcome to just come into the chat when you see I'm streaming and ask me to read it. Or I might just read it randomly. But thank you for watching my stream. Thanks for being part of it. I really appreciate you being part of the stream. Appreciate the cheers and the bits that we received today and all the new followers. And before we end the stream, I always do a stream song.